إخواني أخواتي، أهلا وسهلا بكم إلى هذه الحلقة الجديدة من أدي كرييتر. بطلب من بعض متتبعين في السوشيال ميديا سيكون عنوان هذه الحلقة: كيف ستصبح مدربا في المدرسة. في الأيام القليلة الماضية وضعت صور وفيديوهات في فيسبوك وإنستغرام لبعض المباريات التي لعبناها، ووصلتني بعض الرسائل من متتبعين يسألون كيف أصبحت مدربا، وهناك حتى من طلب مني أن أعمل فيديو لشرح الخطوات والشروط. اليوم بمساعدة زملائي في التدريب عملت لكم هذا الفيديو لنشرح لكم كل الخطوات والشروط لكي تصبح مدربا في المدرسة. معي في هذه الحلقة المدير الرياضي لمدرستنا، سيتكلم على الشهادات والكورسات التي يجب أن تأخذها لكي تصبح مدربا لأي رياضة في المدرسة، ليس فقط كرة القدم. أما أنا والمدرب الآخر سنتكلم على كرة القدم، ونشرح لكم مهام وأعمال المدرب اليومية التي هي نفسها في الرياضات الأخرى. أريد أن أقول شيء مهم: مدرب الرياضة المدرسية هو ليس أستاذ التربية البدنية. لكي تصبح أستاذ للتربية البدنية PE teacher or physical education teacher يجب أن يكون معك شهادة جامعية و teaching license. وضعت فيديو من قبل أتكلم فيه على teaching license أو كيف تصبح مدرسا في أمريكا، وضعت الرابط في الوصف لمن يهمه الأمر. أما مدرب كرة القدم أو أي رياضة أخرى، مدرب الرياضة المدرسية ليس له أي علاقة بالتدريس. صحيح هم يفضلون الأساتذة لأنهم يعرفون المدرسة والطلبة، لكن ليس من الواجب أن تكون أستاذ لكي تصبح مدربا للرياضة المدرسية. قبل أن نبدأ، اعملوا مشاركة في القناة وفعلوا الجرس لكي يصلكم كل جديد. Subscribe to my channel to watch more videos. أريد أيضا أن أدعوكم لزيارة محلنا في أمازون. ادخلوا فقط إلى أمازون واكتبوا AtriGo لرؤية أو شراء التيشيرتات التي صممناها. وضعت أيضا روابط هذه التيشيرتات في وصف كل الفيديوهات التي نشرتها من قبل. قسمت هذه الحلقة إلى ثلاث عناصر مهمة. العنصر الأول هو credentials، الشروط والشهادات. العنصر الثاني coach duties، واجبات ومسؤوليات المدرب. والعنصر الثالث والأخير هو practice and games، الحصص التدريبية والمباريات. نذهب مباشرة الآن إلى العنصر الأول الذي عنوانه credentials، الشروط والشهادات. نترككم مع المدير الرياضي لمدرستنا السيد روبرت دانكن.
Hi, I am Athletic Director Robert Duncan, Riverside High School in Durham, North Carolina. In order to become a coach in Durham Public Schools, there are quite a few credentials and documentation pieces that an individual must satisfy in order to do so. One being health screening. That would be a particular documentation that is done or physical by one's employer or a doctor of your own choosing. In addition to that, insurance and field of study and or resume that must be submitted in order to become employed by Durham Public Schools. In order to become a coach in Durham Public Schools, an individual must satisfy documentation and or coaches requirements listed in the NFHS website. Certificates for individuals who are paid staff members are Fundamentals of Coaching, that is a one-time course, Concussion in Sports, that course must be renewed every single year, as well as First Aid and Safety, and CPR is also a requirement, and sudden cardiac arrest. CPR certifications last for 2 years. NFHS concussion is one that is done every year. In order to become a head coach, individuals should have a CDL, which stands for a commercial driver's license. In most schools, head coaches are responsible for transporting their own programs to and from athletic contests. A CDL can be obtained by contacting your athletic director and or the transportation services center in the city or location that you're residing in. CDLs in Riverside High School are fully reimbursable through our Athletic Booster Club. These are the basic credentials one would need to become a coach in Durham Public Schools.
نذهب الآن للعنصر الثاني الذي سنتكلم فيه أنا والمدرب إريك لونغ على coach duties، بمعنى واجبات ومسؤوليات المدرب اليومية.
I'm Eric Long, varsity soccer coach for the girls team at Riverside High School. It's my fifth year at Riverside and my 17th year as a head soccer coach in high school, varsity level. Coaching duties, a lot of times they start in the season before when you can go watch some of your future players that are going to be coming to your high school in the middle school games, or if you can get to know them through different camps that you can run, or being able to just kind of scout out what you might have coming towards to your school through club games or middle school games. And then when the season is getting ready to start, we do some preseason workouts just so the kids can start getting to play together, getting some sort of shape before the season starts, and then that would go directly into tryouts. The way tryouts would work would, we usually do 3 days of tryouts for every kid, and then at that point make a decision on who's best fit for the soccer program, and let the ones know if they didn't make the team, and let them know that some things that they need to work on, so that if they do come try out again, that maybe they can make it the next year. As far as fundraising goes, we fundraise for many reasons. We fundraise to be able to have equipment to use out on the field, whether it be balls or training equipment. We always try to do fundraising just to have some money in our account for things that arise that unexpectedly we would maybe need to put money towards, and also so we can replenish our jerseys over the years. So when I schedule games, I start looking at getting the conference games done. So when the conference games are scheduled, then I see how many games I have left. We can play 23 games in a season, so usually I get to schedule 8 to 10 games of non-conference games. And by doing that, I'll contact the schools that I'm interested in playing and let them know my open dates and try to work out a game against them if they're wanting to play us. As far as getting prepared for practice each day, it starts usually the night before, where I start thinking about the things that the team needs to work on, and writing out drills and different concepts that we want to go over in practice. And then when I do that, I write out also what equipment's needed for that next practice. So whenever, before practice starts, I go to the equipment shed, get the necessary equipment for that day's practice, and try to get out to the field about 15 to 20 minutes before the team does, so I can start setting up the different areas so that right when they get there, we can get right into practicing.
المدرب دائما يقوم بالتحضير للتدريبات. مثلا نحن في المدرسة عندنا مستودع خاص نضع فيه كل الأغراض التي نحتاجها للتدريبات. يقوم المدرب بأخذ هذه الأغراض قبل بداية التدريبات، ثم يأخذها إلى الملعب الرئيسي، يهيئ الملعب بوضع الأغراض والتمارين في مختلف زوايا الملعب لكي تبدأ التدريبات مباشرة بعد وصول اللاعبات إلى الملعب. المدرب يكون في اتصال دائم مع الأولياء واللاعبين لكي يعلمهم على أي تغييرات تحدث قبل التدريبات أو رزنامة البطولة.
I usually set up email lists through the parents and have one parent run that. Also, I have the captains set up different email lists throughout the players. We also like to contact or put out information on different social media platforms, just any way that the parents can get the information as quickly as possible. So every so often, we have to cut the grass to make sure that we are playing on a field that's in the best condition that it can be. So we have to mow the field with the riding mower, and have to measure the lines out and make sure we line the soccer field, and go over those lines about every week. So, because with the weather and with having games, they tend to get where you can't see them as well. So we go over the lines each week for the next contest that we have. So for every away game, we take a bus. Prior to that, we have to get our CDL license, and we drive the kids to the school that we're playing for the away game. And Then we drive them back and we have to wait for the parents to pick them up. Driving the bus is a necessary way to get the kids to and from the game, and also it helps the parents because sometimes we leave before the parents get off work.
العنصر الثالث والأخير الآن هو practice and games, الحصص التدريبية والمباريات. هنا سنتكلم أكثر على التربية. بما أنه هذه الفرق هي فرق مدرسية, فالمدرب دائما يلعب دور المدرب, الأستاذ, المربي, وأحيانا الطبيب النفسي. أثناء التدريبات نقوم بتعليم الطلبة, نقوم بتهيئتهم بدنيا ونفسيا للمنافسة.
We try to practice every day. I think the more time they get touches on the ball, the better. Even if sometimes you try to make it fun so that they don't have to deal with the grind of having two or three games in a week and always having practice. But if you can try to make it fun sometimes and they still are getting the work in and not realizing really that they're working as hard as they are because they're enjoying what you're doing at practice. But practice as much as possible is very necessary to be a competitive team. So when it comes to game time, we set the lineup, we talk to the kids before the game about different areas of the game that we need them to work on. We talk about our opponents and some of their strengths and maybe some of their weaknesses and ways that we can compete with the team we're playing against and hopefully come out as winners in the game. I talk to them a lot at the beginning of the game to motivate them, to try to talk them up and let them know that we can be successful today if we do certain things. So we have to manage substitutions, we talk about formation, different things throughout the game that I'm instructing and the other coaches are instructing as well, as far as pushing kids up, pushing them back, making sure they're staying in the proper formation, or switching the ball, or doing just many different things out there that we see on the fly that we have to let them know to do. As halftime approaches, then we get to talk to them about everything that's going great and everything that's not going great, reset our formation, reset everything we want to do in the game, and if we're winning, then hopefully we can come up with ideas and ways for us to continue winning, and if we're losing, then we look to maybe push a little harder, more offensively to be able to equalize the game.
دائما المدرب يحاول أن يخلق جو عائلي في الفريق لتشجيع اللاعبين, لمساعدتهم, لتعليمهم, وخاصة لتحضيرهم بدنيا ونفسيا للمنافسة.
If you can build your team up and you get them to start believing in themselves and believing in their teammates, then it does a world of good when you're out there. It makes you be able to stay in games, keep them closer, and gives you an opportunity to win. We as coaches here, we look at winning as not necessarily always the outcome of the score, but as us getting better each practice, getting better each game, and you see in that progression of how successful we're getting because we're getting better and we're learning all the things that we're teaching, and that's where we see the victory.
سنختم هذا الفيديو بهذه اللقطات الجميلة من إحدى لاعباتنا المميزة. أتمنى أن تستمتعوا, أتمنى أن نكون قد أجبنا على كل أسئلتكم. لا تنسوا أن تعملوا مشاركة في القناة وتشاركوا هذا الفيديو مع أصدقائكم لكي يستفيد الجميع. Subscribe to my channel to watch more videos. لا تنسوا أيضا أن تتابعونا في السوشيال ميديا, ولا تنسوا أن تزوروا محلنا الخاص في أمازون, وضعت الرابط في الوصف. حظ موفق للجميع and bye.